Hello. Ooh, that's loud, isn't it? Thank you very much for coming. So I'm Matt Denton, and I'm a creature effects engineer. That's my day job, but I'm also a YouTube creator. And this is James Bruton, the well-known YouTube creator. And unfortunately, yes, Ruth can't be with us today. She picked up a touch of COVID. So sadly, she hasn't been able to join us. So James and I have been frantically redoing our presentation this morning. And we probably spent a bit too much time in null sector last night, which didn't help. But we're here now. So I'm going to kick off with a bit about me, and then we're going to swap to James, and it'll come back to me again. And we're just going to talk a little bit about our YouTube channels and how we got to where we are. And then I'll do a bit about my work. I don't know if people were here in 2018, anyone? 2018? Okay, so you might have seen I did a talk then about my work. I will cover some of my work later on, just some of the highlights and some new bits that I've done. So let's have a look. Oh yeah, so my day job is I work on in films, and I'm probably best known for working on BB-8. So like I say, I will go back to that later on if we've got time. But there is a good talk in 2018 that I've already covered a lot of that stuff in. This is one of the many BB-8s. We have 7 whilst we're filming, just so you know, and that's a few of them. We're getting prepped on set there. This is the very first appearance of BB-8. So no one had seen it at this point, and everyone thought it was going to be a digital effect. And then we drove this out on stage live at Star Wars Celebration, and the crowd went wild. And it was quite a big moment for me personally, because it was the scariest thing I've ever done. We love freeze framing on this guy here, whose mouth's wide open. And he's got a camera in his hand. He hadn't even picked his camera up to take a picture. So basically, that moment when BB-8 rolled out on stage inspired lots of people to start wanting to figure out how to build one, because no one thought it could actually be done. And one of those people was James Bruton. And someone found out, I live in Winchester, James lives in Winchester, somebody found out that I worked on BB-8, and they were like, do you know there's a guy building one on his YouTube channel in Winchester? And I was like, no. So basically, they got us in touch, and that's how James and I met, through that BB-8 clip and him building one, what looked like in his loft. At this point, I'm going to hand you over to James, segue to James's BB-8 build, and I'll come back a bit later.
All right, thank you. We just need to plug the HDMI in there. If you would just get... we've got 2 separate presentations that we didn't know how to merge, which we wrote this morning. So, my name's James Bruton. I'm a YouTube content creator. I've been full-time on YouTube for about 3 years. I've been making weekly videos, apart from the odd week, pretty much, that have come out every Tuesday morning at 7 o'clock for 8 years. And I've been seriously making content for 10 years. So I have kind of 1.1 million subscribers now, which seems like a lot, but it's basically a symptom of having made content intently for all of that time. So I guess if you just carry on for long enough, you get there eventually. Oh. Just a moment. Oh, no, that's not it.
Gone too far. There
we go. Right. So since about 2008, I tried to build an Iron Man suit, and it was a project that went on for many, many years. So I actually deleted some of the early YouTube videos of ones I did in clay sculpts because they weren't that good. But in 2010, I started building an Iron Man suit, and it was all foam templates. And then it went on for many, many years because I wasn't sort of doing YouTube full time then. So there were other projects, and sometimes the Iron Man suit stopped for 3 months. And but basically I ended up making a foam suit and then actually making molds off the foam, and then casting it rigid in polyurethane and fiberglass. So I had this 4-year project. There were about 50 videos on YouTube. And I ended up with an Iron Man suit, which I've still got in boxes. So that was where I sort of started getting subscribers on YouTube. I think that got me the first 50,000. And a lot of people, if I see them at comic cons and things, hey, you're that Iron Man guy. But now it's quite a long time ago. So as Matt mentioned, I then moved on to try and build BB-8 when Star Wars Episode 7 came out. I actually did three versions, and eventually I did another BB-9E for an official promo that eBay did in conjunction with Disney. So this is my BB-8 version 3. It did work, I've got a video in a moment, and I built it to look like the cutaway that was in the Star Wars Episode 7 Visual Dictionary, which is why there's a big hole in its head. So let's just see if this video's going to play. So I had slightly less budget than Matt did in Pinewood Creature Effects. The main motors that drive this are windscreen wiper motors I got off eBay, and they were scrap ones that cost £2 each. So there's two of those in there and a bunch of other servos and bits and pieces. But it's actually got all of the six axes of motion, so the ball can spin and it can lean to steer and it drives forwards and backwards, and the head also moves side to side, forward and back, and can rotate. So it gives us six axes. And it is dynamically stable. You can see the insides thrashing around there to try and stabilize it. I could probably do a better job now, but it wasn't too bad for £2 motors and some 3D prints that I made in my back bedroom. And so Matt revealed how BB-8 worked at the Star Wars Celebration in a year, 2016, 17, which was the first time anyone had seen inside the real BB-8. And this footage was at that event, so I actually had one working by the time it was revealed. I do have a serious robotics, though, so I kind of tried to move away from Iron Man, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment as well. So more recently, I've been doing serious robotics projects. I've got, well, three versions of robot dogs. I've got Open Dog 3 here. That's Open Dog version 2. And but if you count all of the test dogs and test legs, there's actually about seven. So I've kind of saturated YouTube with sort of these long series of making robot dog projects. I also spent some time to learn about ROS, which is a robot operating system, which is an open source framework for doing lots of things. There's lots of modules. The one I was really interested in was autonomous navigation. So I built this robot that's got a LiDAR on it, which can scan and map the room, and then I'm using the navigation stack to make it autonomously navigate. So you can put an arrow down, and then it'll go from A to B, and if you put objects on the map, it'll mark them on the map and drive around them, and when they disappear, it'll clear them. So I took about a year to learn how to do this. So my content's kind of moved from this, you know, pop culture, Iron Man, doing all these things from movies into more serious robotics. So there's a few other examples of some projects I did. These specific ones were in 2020, pretty much. I've moved on to some other projects since then. But they're quite serious things. So the top left is a balancing strand beast that balanced like a two-wheel balancing robot but walked on a row of legs, and some various other serious projects with force control and various other grippers and things like that. Apart from when brands asked me to do something pop culture, so I did a couple of collaborations with Colin Furze. One of those was for the Hulkbuster, where we did there was a big reveal video where we surprised some children. It was eBay licensed the IP from Marvel to use their IP to promote eBay, and the spin on this was everything had to be bought from eBay. So Colin did a lot of the work, of course, to build this. My job was the electronics and the control system and the risk assessment, and also the cosmetic panels I had to design so they could all be rolled out of steel. So if anyone's ever seen Peppercura, which is like papercraft, it's like that, but massive, to be made out of steel. And all that had to be approved by Marvel in the US. So it's like papercraft, but massive and steel. And then Colin and his team rolled it out of steel and welded it all up to make all of the cosmetics. I also built, BB-9E when Episode 8 came out. Again, that was another eBay, everything has to be bought from eBay promo, where they licensed Star Wars, and Colin, of course, made something much bigger than I did. He made the TIE fighter, or the TIE silencer. It didn't fly. It would have been awesome if it did. It was absolutely massive. So yeah, I built a BB-9E, which had to drive off-road, which was quite challenging on grass. So I said it would work on grass. I tested it in my garden. But I said, whatever you do, you know, keep the grass long so it's nice and spongy and helps damp it. And if it's smooth grass, it'll be fine. And we turned up and they'd ploughed the grass to sort of let air in this country house estate. So it's an absolute nightmare. So we had to go and get sheets of plywood and fake grass to put on the real grass so we could drive it at all. The other one that I did that was quite big, I did by myself, and I actually employed someone to help me do the foam work, was when Paramount released Bumblebee, the movie. So we made a life-size VW Beetle, which transformed into a 3.5-meter-tall robot. And then we set up another big reveal video to make people feel good, surprising some people in a garage with the genuine public, where the production company hired the garage, and then they got existing customers, told them to come in for a free winter tire check, and then said, wait over there, and then we transformed this thing in front of them. Being typical British people, a lot of people didn't know what to do. You know, if they'd been American, it would have been much better, but a lot of people just kind of went, oh no, what's going on? And some people brought their children in, which was arranged, and the parents are in on it. And they, you know, the video is them watching it transform. And then they tried to interview them afterwards. And we said sort of, what did you think of that? Very nice. Was it exciting? Yes. So there was one guy who saved the day who was like really over the top. So I'm going to tell you why I deleted 100 million views. I think I've got enough zeros there from my YouTube channel. So I mentioned I used to do Iron Man cosplays. And those were some of the most popular videos. The Iron Man suit, there was 54 videos. I combined into a 4-minute video, and that went up in 2016. And up to 2020, it was still doing 1 million views a month. There's another one about a Hulkbuster suit, which, 9 million views. And there's several others with millions of views on, which I've now marked private or unlisted, so you can't see them on YouTube anymore. The Iron Man suit summary in September 2020 did 7.8 million views in a month, and right in the middle there, on Monday, September the 14th, 2020, did 1 million views in a day. So, this sounds great, right? A viral video with whatever it had on it, 76 million views, a day. That's amazing, but it wasn't actually amazing, so I'm just going to play the video while I tell you why. Let's just hope this works. It is on there, good. Right, so this is a screen capture of the YouTube thing, so you can see the view count. So, the YouTube algorithm kept pushing this to people because people watched it, because it was quite a viral video showing the whole suit being built from scratch. 4 years progress into 4 minutes. The way the algorithm works is that if you watch a video from a channel, even if you don't subscribe, and then you go on the front page of YouTube, for the channels in the most recent 100 videos you've watched, it will keep feeding you videos from that channel. So you'll see more suggested videos, even though you haven't subscribed, because it thinks you want to watch more, especially if you watched all of that video and the retention was really good. So this video is getting 1 million views a day at some point. Most of the views were from demographics like Indonesia, Mexico, Thailand, Brazil, where advertising rates aren't very good. So I didn't actually get that much money for it. But mostly it was people who wanted to watch a viral Iron Man cosplay video. So by then my content, as I mentioned, had progressed into more serious robotics. So what happened was these 1 million people a day were getting suggested all my more recent videos, but they didn't click on them, because it wasn't an Iron Man cosplay. It was something titled, you know, it was in-depth information on ROS topics and the data structure of ROS and how autonomous robots work. So it wasn't a clickable video, and the people who were getting suggested it didn't click on it. So if you don't have good click-through on your videos, then YouTube doesn't show them to any more people. So all of my content during that September period where this Iron Man video was spiking up, all just went all the way down to half what it should be. So I basically removed 100 million views worth of videos, all these viral videos, I just basically marked private or unlisted. And then in about 3 months, things recovered where basically subscribers were getting suggested my content on Serious Robotics they'd subscribed for, and then I managed to like triple my view count. So yeah, having a viral video isn't always a good thing. Right, so I'm gonna hand over to Matt again now to carry on with his section. And if there's time, I'll come back and tell you some other things.
I'd like a million views a day. Please. Yes, so hang on a second, let's start this up again. After meeting James and having this common interest that he's building the BB-8, I built the BB-8 and seeing his YouTube channel. I did a little bit of stuff on YouTube, but not really anything serious. And so it was after meeting James that I thought, oh, maybe I should start doing some stuff. You know, I've got some ideas. So I started my channel, Mantis Hacks. And the name comes from the mantis. If you were here in 2018, you might remember the mantis. This is a lovely sunny day back in 2018. And this is James and I trying not to crush a cup. James foolishly puts his finger underneath the foot, which is a terrible idea. But anyway, the whole machine moves around and it barely moves the cups to show the kind of control you have to have in inverse kinematic control and hydraulics. And it's a plastic cup, so it's very crushable. And I can't remember who filmed this, but he gave this video to me, but he missed the crush, unfortunately. So I started Mantis Hacks up. But my whole point was I really liked doing things like, you know, big hydraulic projects and engineering, and I was going to hack the Mantis. I was going to add things to it, add functionality, change things. I still want to do it, but this whole thing about this YouTube, don't necessarily end up doing what you necessarily want to do or enjoy. You have to kind of follow the views, which is, it's not necessarily a good thing. So when I started out building this gripper, because I was going to add this huge gripper to the front of the Mantis, because whenever I do shows with it, it's really nice to, it would be lovely to be able to interact with things. And I've built previous hexapods many years ago, much smaller ones, and I had little mandible grippers on the front so they could walk along, pick stuff up, move them around a table, and people were just mesmerized by that. So I thought if I do it on a large scale with the Mantis, it'll be even better because I can crush things with it as well, because everyone likes things being crushed. So I CAD this thing up and I built quite a lot of it. Ooh, let's go back one. And this is just a clip from one of my videos. I built this little miniature hydraulic power pack, which I really enjoyed. The crushers behind me there, the mandibles. And in fact, we crushed one of James's original Iron Man masks in the crushers, and people hated you for that, didn't they?
It did really badly,
yeah. So, you know, it was a lovely bit of build, this mask, but it was a really old one. He'd done better things since, and we decided to crush it. It didn't go very well. So anyway, it just wasn't really working. I was enjoying the work. I enjoyed the engineering. I enjoyed making the videos, but I wasn't getting any views. So I knew I had to change something. And then one day, I noticed that James was, he 3D printed a giant Lego brick. And at this point I had a TAS 5 3D printer. And I was like, oh, that's a good idea. I'll try and print some 3D Lego. But I said, I think it'd be really cool if you could do a whole kit, you know, just upscale the whole kit and print it. And for some reason I had in my head a go-kart, because at the time my nephew was about 5 or 6. And I thought, I wonder if I could print it big enough so he could sit in this go-kart and actually drive it around. So I scaled up, I found a go-kart kit. It was about 98 pieces, quite a lot of pieces in it. At the time I was working in ABS, filament, and I found the largest part on the go-kart, and I thought, right, how big can I get on my bed? I think the TAS 5 is about 280 mil square, so I put it diagonally across the bed. It was a 2x8 plate. And that was it. That was the scale determined. It was 5 times larger. So I stuck with this 5x scale, and I started printing this go-kart. And this is actually just a quick montage of that video, and you can kind of get the idea of how it goes. So my My nephew Ruben builds the original kit at normal in actual Lego, and then I do my Lego-inspired 3D printed large-scale version. And it just went really nicely. It was one of those videos that it didn't do masses on my YouTube channel, but instantly took off compared to everything else. But it also got picked up by a lot of places, and there was a channel that took it, and they asked my permission and said, could we do a little cut down of it? It wasn't too dissimilar to that, actually. And they put it on their Facebook page. It did 1 million views in a week. So I suddenly realized I was onto something. You know, it was instantly recognizable, and everyone just was like blown away by the fact that it was giant scaled Lego inspired. I have to put the inspired in there. It's not actually Lego. And it just sort of it spiraled from there. But unfortunately, it's also, I've now got to a point that's kind of what I'm known for. But the whole point was to make it big enough for Ruben to be able to ride. And you can see there, he's about 6, I think, and there's no way he's going to fit on it. There's definitely no way I'm going to fit on it. So anyway, that in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, I've got to get to that point at some point where I can make it big enough that he can ride it. So anyway, to carry on from that, I then went back through my childhood Lego kits and thought, right, what will I do first? This is the first one I ever had. It was the Lego forklift. And it's actually the first Lego Technic kit ever released, 1977, I think. I did this in 2017, which was the 40-year anniversary. So bigger again, I think nearly 200 pieces. And then we did the bulldozer. That was 400 pieces, and I made it radio-controlled, and it's very powerful. It can tow me around at events quite often. I've got a little trailer on the back. And then we did the tractor, because it was another 70s kit. Again, really good fun and really huge tires. By this point, very fortunately, I'd now been sponsored by Lulzbot for the printers, so I had a couple of printers now, and also Polymaker, the filament supplier. So at this point, it's much easier to carry on because these kits are about 30 kilos of filament each, and I'm now printing in PLA as well, so it's much easier to print in. And that's really good because that tire that Ruben's holding above his head is made in 4 segments, and each segment, I think, is about £50 worth of filament because it's TPU. So it's more expensive than any car tire that I've ever owned, which is horrible to think about, but very useful. I was also well aware at this point that Ruben is like really photogenic and just puts me to shame in every picture. And I have no qualm in saying that I'm using him for my YouTube videos because he's getting views. and I will continue to use him. But he wants commission. He won't get it yet. So my latest is I've got to keep getting bigger and better each time. The latest one I'm doing at 5x scale is the Lego Classic car chassis kit, which I think is the best Lego kit ever made. If anyone here is a Lego aficionado, I don't know, but the best Lego Technic kit ever made. Had 3-speed gearbox, 4-piston engine, Ackerman steering, suspension. You know, they really went to town on this kit. And in the 80s, if you got this for Christmas, it was like the best. So I'm doing it in stages because it is, I've worked it out, it's going to be about 80 kilos of filament. I've done the engine, which is with us here, if you want to come and have a look at it. I've done the seat so far, and I've actually printed most of the parts for the chassis, and I'm planning on getting Ruben in to help me on that episode to help put it together, because he's not been involved in this one yet. But I also wanted to get the go-kart to a size that you can actually ride it, of course. So that is the same go-kart, the blue one we saw at the start, but scaled up to 8.34 times scale. Really weird scale. And it's to do with how big I could get on my printer again. And when you're scaling up, I have to put bearings in this. So when I scale up by a factor of 5, that the Technic axles work out that a 24mm bearing fits them. And this one, it was a 40mm bearing at 8.3 recurring, so I rounded up to 8.34. And so purely so I can use 40mm bearings. And it was just about big enough for me to sit on, barely. But I have done 30 miles an hour on that. It's terribly sketchy. The steering's got heaps of play. It's a terrible rack and pinion system. It's parallel linked. But the brakes work well. It's got disc brakes. It had to have disc brakes. And I'm just explaining there that I'd lost the brakes, but the accelerator was still working, so everything's fine. In fact, James was filming that for me. He was hanging out my van, driving up and down a parade ground in Gosport, a naval parade ground. But it was still a bit cramped, so I thought, right, I'm going to make it bigger, so I actually extended it. So this is the long wheelbase version. And I was helped out with the longer parts by a YouTuber called Ivan Miranda. You might know him. He's built some really large-scale printers, so he printed me some longer beams so I could extend the wheelbase. And then the last video we did on this one is that I made drift rims for the back, so those back wheels are completely smooth now, and it's just hilarious fun to drive. And in fact, so this is the first time Ruben got to play on it, because it's stupidly powerful. It's about 7,000 watts of motor power in it. But it turns out that Ruben's really good at drifting. He's been doing a bit of go-karting, and his reaction times are just tons better than mine. It's the obligatory Top Gear slow-mo shot. I was just going around in circles doing donuts, but he could kind of react fast enough. And also, being that he's only, I don't know, 45 kilos or something, I don't know how much he weighs, but he touches the accelerator and it spins up straight away. I get on it and it grips. So then I have to kind of throw it into a corner to get it to spin, but. Yeah, raw talent, look at that. So I ended up basically getting pinned into this Lego mayhem where I've just been building more and more Lego-inspired 3D printed creations. So the success of that first video with Ruben and myself making that little blue Lego go-kart has set what my channel has become. I have done other things as well. I've done a droid build, a DO droid build for Star Wars. And I've done some other bits and pieces. I did a whole series on that one. But none of them do as well as the giant 3D printed builds. And so I find it a little bit frustrating because YouTube is determined, or the success of a video is determined what I do. Like James found the success of Iron Man determined what he did for a while. And he's been brave enough to delete his 1 million views a day. And I'm not brave enough because I don't get anywhere near those views. And I'm also, so James does YouTube full time now. And I've not got to that point where I feel like I just leave my, I finish my work and go off and do YouTube full time. Maybe if I did it, it would start to change for me. But I think that's what Ruth was going to talk about when she was here as well. I believe she made something when she was doing GCSEs. The stair steady, and obviously she's got a very good YouTube channel now. Kids make stuff, kids invent stuff. Sorry, Ruth, if you're watching. And so I think the stair steady video follows her around. I think that's what she was telling us. But yes, people didn't believe she invented it because she did it during her GCSEs, which is amazing. Actually, I've looked at it now, and it is incredible. I'm slightly jealous. So, that's my YouTube side of stuff. Let's check the time here. We've got a bit of time left, 20 minutes. So I can go into some of my work stuff. So yes, I haven't left work and done YouTube full time. I'd love to do more engineering stuff on my channel, but my channel seemed to predict what I'm going to do, which is 3D printing big things. I don't feel like I can do that forever because I'm also slightly concerned that I am going through literally tons of filament. And there's only so much Lego you can put in your house when it's at that scale. It's already filling my lounge up. The thing that I'm building now is going to end up being 2.5 meters long by a meter wide. No idea where that's going to go. So, yeah, I'm not sure where my channel's going. So in my work, so if you were here in 2018, I went through my animatronics work, which I've been doing for 27 years. And I'm just going to go through some of the more advanced stuff that I do. So my speciality is in the control systems for animatronics, so that's software electronics engineering, although I do mechanical stuff as well. That's what I do for creature effects for my job, is the electronics software control systems. And a lot of the time what we do is we obviously use puppeteers to puppeteer the creation, whether it be BB-8, a droid, or it's a creature. So I've worked on Harry Potter, like the hippogriff, for example, is one of the things we built, and we'd have puppeteers controlled in the animatronic hippogriff. And so it could be creature, droid, or something else. But generally speaking, it needs a puppeteer. So what I've been working on since, well, about 2013, is trying to find ways of not eliminating the puppeteer, because that sounds mean, because I've got lots of friends who are puppeteers, but trying to get better performance or more real or lifelike performance out of inanimate objects like animatronics. So one thing I looked at was face tracking, and this is live face tracking applied to an animatronic head, and this is a very early test from 2013, me less the beard. So this is a bit of software called Face Shift, which I then adapted and wrote some plugins for. But the point being, this is an animatronic head just from the eyes up. But it was tracking my face and eye movements and applying them to the animatronic head live. The point of that was that we were thinking, if we had an actor that was going to play a character rather than that having a puppeteer, then the actor could drive the performance rather than the puppeteer having to drive the performance based on the actor's voice, which is what usually happens. So this system actually worked really nicely, but was quite complex to set up. We did do a full face where it had the mouth as well working, and it's quite hard to tell from this, but the eyes are some of the most natural eye movement we'd ever seen on an animatronic, because they're not puppeteered, they're actually tracking my eye movements. And it's all those little jitters you get and little blinks as you move around. It's a really hard thing to get right. So we were all blown away by this at the time. It probably looks a bit weird because there's no skin on it, but it was impressive to us at the time. The problem is that there was a lovely bit of software, like I say, called Face Shift. And it was a guy called Tebow, I think I used to deal with, and very nice chap. And then one night, it just disappeared overnight, like gone, the company's gone. And if you know on all your phones now, they'll do face tracking, and they'll, you know, do your, remorph you into something else. Well, that's his company. He got bought by Apple. So he's doing all right, but he left me in the dark. So yeah, really, not really nice bit of software. But what's amazing about that is at the time, we were using little, the Microsoft Kinect sensors, you know, the depth sensors, which were about that wide and about that big, about that deep. There was a little smaller version about this big, but when, as soon as Apple got involved, they shrunk it down to fit in the top of your phone. That's amazing, because I couldn't believe you could get it down that small, because we were trying to make it so that you could wear the sensor. So I had to put a Microsoft Kinect on top of a helmet with a mirror so it could see the face, and it was so big and clumsy. Apple did it like that, because they got loads of money. So that was actually being used. That test was a test, a very early test. We were going to do an animatronic version of Maz Kanata. In the end, that one became digital. This is in the early film. But then we did eventually do an animatronic version of Maz, which was the last film, episode 9. And this footage is me doing some animatronic live motion capture. So I'm dressed up like I'm about to play tennis with the headband on, but that is tracking my head. And it's all IMU-based sensors rather than camera tracking, so we wouldn't have to set up cameras and nodes and all that kind of thing. It's literally just tracking the suit that I'm wearing rather than having to track an object using a vision or camera. But it's working beautifully here, and we actually built Maz from the waist up. So we had an animatronic head, and everything worked from the waist up. She never saw it from the waist down. That would have been a digital shot, and she would move around from the hips. We could make her look like she walked. She'd walk along a gliding track, and the arms would be performed by a puppeteer, a friend of mine called Claire, and she'd wear that suit that I'm wearing, and she'd perform the arms and the head movement, the gross head movement. We had another puppeteer doing the facial, the lip syncing and what have you, live on set, and then I would control the eyes. There was three of us controlling Maz when we were doing the filming. But really nice to use actual live motion capture directly translated to animatronic. So one of the things I really enjoyed doing as a character in particular that came up is kinetic and procedural animation. So that would be like the blinks would be procedural if I made them automatic. So I have auto blinks. So they're just, the character will just blink automatically at random timings based on human behavior. Or it could breathe, for example. That would be procedural. So it just keeps going in the background. So it's another thing you don't have to worry about puppeteering. But the kinetic stuff was really interesting. So that is based on the movement of the puppet's head or the creature's head. So quite often, obviously, these creatures have a performer inside of them, and we put a mask on top of the performer, which has the animatronic in. And this early test was for a head, which was obviously on a stick at this point, but all of the eye movement and blinks are based on the movement on the head. So as I'm moving it up and down, it throws a blinking, because generally speaking, it's a really cheap trick to do, but when you're puppeteering something, if the head moves, blink your eyes. And you don't always do it, but sometimes you do, and it works really well on film if you just throw a blink in as the eye focus changes. So this does it all automatically. So all of that is just done by me tilting the head and moving it around and tweaking filters and stuff like that. So this is like kinetic or free animation. So this was the very first test we did. This was actually a test head. It was going to be K2SO from Rogue One, but which became digital. But this was a little animatronic head we did for that. And then I got to use it to the nth degree on this guy. Six Eyes, Argus Six Eyes Panox. So this was had an actor inside of the head here. He's wearing this animatronic mask, a guy called Derek. And this beautiful animatronic built by a friend of mine called Gustav. It had about 70 motors in it, I think, 60 or 70 motors, because each eye is on a stalk, and each eye can move in all directions, and, you know, six eyes, and there's lips as well. It's a really complex animatronic head, but as soon as I saw it, I thought, this is perfect for kinetic animation. So I put an IMU in the head, inertial measurement unit, so that's picking up the angle of the head and the rate of change. It was so good on set. People will come onto set, and this was in a card table game. They're playing a game of cards. And back behind set, there was the director's tent with all the monitors. It's like a little area that you can go and watch what's going on set without actually being on set. And someone came on set one day, apparently, went into the director's tent, looked at the monitor, saw this thing moving, and went, how are we doing live CG renders, computer graphic renders, in camera? Now, like, well, it's not computer graphics, it's an animatronic. He said, no. So he had to go round to the set and look at it for real, because he didn't believe what we were doing with an animatronic. And this is me demoing it in Celebration 2019 with my boss, Neil Scanlon, there. He's the head of creatures. So as you can see, this is all based on me moving it around. So as whilst Derek is wearing the head, he could look at the table and the eyes would look down at the table, which is really hard for me to predict when Derek's going to move unless we have lots of rehearsal. And we don't get much rehearsal these days. So when you can do something like that and get those beautiful reactions, knowing that when Derek wants to look at his cards, he just looks at the table and the eyes will come down with it. If he wants to look at the guy next to him, he just does that and the eyes will go over there. So there was key points. Again, we had a puppeteer doing the mouth, and I was doing the manual overrides on the eyes. But all I would have to do is, like, there's one shot where one eye goes off to the side to look, to cheat and try and look at the other player's cards. So I would override that, and I would do that manually. But otherwise, everything else is just Derek moving his head around, you know, nodding, the blinks would be in there, thrown in and stuff. So it was a really nice way to bring all that technology together and apply it at a final stage. We've got 10 minutes left. I have now started working on a jetpack, which I haven't got matter to talk about that, but I thought I might throw this back to James for a bit, and if there's time, I'll just show you this jet engine fired up, because you've got something else you can go back to. Yeah. Okay. No, I think there's 10 minutes left, or just under 10 minutes, so.
Thank you. Can we just... I can't see it from here. Is it on? Good. I've got exactly 5 minutes and 4 seconds. Let's just get that to go full screen. Is it going to? Oh, I don't know. Anyway, that'll do. So I told you about how I removed these Iron Man videos to get basically people, whoever they are, subscribed or unsubscribed, to watch my videos that I wanted. So since then, basically through 2021 and what we've had already of 2022, I've been doing some more serious robotics projects, which have been doing much better views. So I've been doing some more in-depth stuff, like balancing robots with extra stability control, like that clip. Also, I've kind of got obsessed with this idea of a one-wheel balancing robot that can stand on the spot. So this is two wheels in line. It's using control moment gyroscopes. So if you spin a mass at a constant velocity and move it in one control axis, then it wants to move in a perpendicular axis. So this is being used for stabilizing boats and things like that. So I've got an inertial measurement unit on there, which is measuring how much it's falling over. And then in the perpendicular axis, the gyros move, and that causes a perpendicular force to keep it upright. So I built this one-wheel robot, which can almost stay still on the spot. It probably could have done with a bit of a position hold algorithm, which is balancing front to back like a Segway or a hoverboard and side to side with two control moment gyros, which was probably actually the best one-wheel balancing robot that I did. There's a couple of others coming up in a moment, including an active omni-wheel. So an omni-wheel is a wheel with lots of wheels, typically around the circumference, so it can slide in one direction and drive in the other. So I went through a couple of videos trying to make one with the little wheels being driven. And I did this one with belts twisted 90 degrees to translate the motion round. And that means it can move sideways as well as front to back. And then it stabilizes in both axes like a two-axis balancing robot, which pretty much worked. I've actually got this wheel here if anyone wants to have a look at it. It's back at our camp. The only challenge was because of the little wheels following the contour of the big wheel, the diameter changes on those little wheels. So sometimes there's more velocity and sometimes there's less velocity, which meant it didn't always balance as well as it could. I then went on and experimented with reaction wheels, and I'll come back to reaction wheels in about 2 minutes. So this is a mass basically that spins in either direction around a stationary center point, and that causes an opposite reaction to make something balance. So then I went on to do a one-wheel balancing robot with a reaction wheel, which didn't work quite as well as the gyros, but it does nonetheless stand on one wheel. So the future of the channel, what I'd say phase three, is making some of these things bigger. So I've now rented a workshop. I've had a welder and a CNC machine for a while, but I've got those things out and I've got some space to test bigger vehicles. So this video actually had 1.6 million views as of today, and it only went out 3 weeks ago. So it's a viral video that I want to be viral that's related to my current topics that I do. So this is the Can I Ride an Omni-Wheel Bicycle video, where it balances sideways like a Segway or a hoverboard, and I can ride normally because the little wheels all around the circumference allow it still to slide sideways. So I can ride it like a normal bike, and just stop on the spot and spin around 180 degrees and then switch on or switch off the balancing again and ride off. It's peculiar to ride with the balancing system on, because if you go to steer left on a bike, you steer right a little bit to turn left. But what actually happens when you lean right is it keeps going right, even though you're desperately turning the handlebars the other way. This project went out in the last 2 weeks. It was a 2 week build, and I've got this here as well. You might have seen it with a red chair on, driving around. This is another type of omni wheel. I did a smaller version exactly a year ago. It was May 2021, and lots of people said, make one you can ride on. So now I've got the space to do it. Here it is. So it's another type of omni wheel, which was inspired by a project from Osaka University in Japan. Essentially, the hemispheres spin freely like the little wheels, and the wheel is a ball shape. And no one's seen this project yet because it comes out next Tuesday. It's a reaction wheel on my back to help me balance. So I think the title's going to be called Tightrope Walking Cheat Device. I didn't think it was going to work, but it was okay for a one-week project. So, it does kind of work, and there's more information in the video when it comes out. So future plans for projects are basically making everything I've made in the last year or so, but big enough to ride on. So we're going to see some crazy vehicles. I want to do an omnidirectional bicycle with ball-shaped wheels. Is definitely one of the ones that's coming up. Right, so we've got 5 minutes. Yep. Do you want to do jetpacks?
I'll just do a quick question.
Yeah, so I have a few people ask me about why. Well, if you go follow me on Mantis Robot on Instagram or Twitter, at Mantis Robot, a few people have asked about what I'm doing with a jetpack. I am developing a jetpack, which is a self-stabilized jetpack for a company I set up with a business partner called Maverick Aviation. I don't really have much information at the moment or anything I can really show, but I have got just a clip of one engine being fired up. I can tell you, so it's running now at, you see, 80,000 RPM is going up. They tick over at 33,000 RPM. They're terrifying, and they run at 98,000 RPM. This is a 2 kilogram or 2.2 kilo turbine engine. It can deliver 30 kilos of thrust. So it's an incredible thrust to weight ratio. And it's running on this vectored system that I've designed. And there I'm literally just shuttling it back and forwards to see what happens to the system. It's a very early test, this. So yeah, there's going to be several of those strapped to me. It's like 6 of them or something like that to give enough thrust. So if you don't see me again, that's probably what did it. The other thing is they're really loud. So each engine's 120 decibels. And with 6 of them running, it's like instantly deaf unless you've got, ear protection. And they produce so much fumes. They're burning a liter of aviation fuel a minute, each one. So 6 liters a minute of fuel. It's not the most environmentally friendly system, but that's not the point. In fact, James and I have both flown the gravity jetpack, Richard Browning's jet suit, which is hilarious fun. So yes, I think that kind of wraps it up. We've got like 2 minutes, so if anyone wants to run up with a question, you can ask us a question, or you have to accost us back at our camp. So yeah, there we go. Thank you very much.